Okay, good evening. Good evening, everyone, and thanks for coming to this wonderful event. Inaugural lectures are always a real treat, and I think this one is going to be something a little bit exceptional. I'm very much looking forward to it. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Simon Lucas. I'm the Professor of Artificial Intelligence, and I'm also very proud to say Head of the School of Electronic Engineering and Computer Science here at Queen Mary University of London. We also know that the school is EECS. Now, EECS is a fantastic place. We're definitely one of the leading schools in the country, in the area. And we have more than 100 academic staff and more than 220 PhD students. And overall, there's a lot of fantastic research going on. Much of the research is having great impact. And the lecture that you're going to hear tonight is a fantastic example of exactly that sort of thing. Inaugural lecture is going to be given by Professor Josh Reiss. I pronounced his name correctly as well, so that's a good start. In his extensive career, he's published more than 200 scientific papers and more than 50 of these in premier journals, including four best paper awards. He's co-authored the textbook on audio effects theory, implementation, and application. And Josh is part of the Center for Digital Music, which is, without question, one of the leading centres in the world for digital music and audio. And Queen Mary University are very proud of C4DN and everything that it's achieved in attracting fantastic people like Josh. So it's a really great to be part of this. His research has been featured in dozens of articles and interviews over the last decade, and has been featured in places like The Guardian, BBC World Service, BBC News, Forbes International, New Scientist, and Channel 4, and many, many other places. Part of what we do as academics is the pure research bit, part of its impact, and part of it is service to the community. And Josh really just fires on all the cylinders in this. And in part of the service to the research community, he's been governor of the Audio Engineering Society, he's been chair of their Publications Policy Committee, and also co-chair of the Technical Committee on High Resolution Audio. He recently had a Royal Academy of Engineering Enterprise Fellowship, and these are fellowships which you're expected to develop some sort of entrepreneurial activity. And Josh just did an exceptional job in this. So he formed a high-tech spin-out company called Lambda, which currently has more than 1.5 million subscribers and is valued at over £30 million. And this takes very cutting-edge audio research and puts it into commercial products. And to achieve this is something fantastic. So he covers a large remit within digital audio and has investigated things like psychoacoustics, sound synthesis, multi-channel signal processing, intelligent music production, and digital audio effects. His primary focus of research, which ties together many of the above topics, is on the use of state-of-the-art signal processing techniques for professional sound engineering. And in addition to the other things he does, he also maintains a blog, a YouTube channel, and a Twitter channel. And I recommend that you have a look at his YouTube channel and look at some of the effects, some of which you're going to hear this evening as well. But what some of the core of what Josh does is in cutting-edge sound synthesis. And I just love the idea that you can take these models of systems and just compute them. And from those computations, which can be quite low level and quite fast, produce fantastic, amazing audio, which you can then embed in products. And I think that's really fantastic. And I've listened to some of the stuff, it's really, really amazing. So some of the key questions that he's going to address this evening. What are the limits of human hearing? Can we create a realistic virtual world without relying on recorded samples? So a lot of the impressive audio that you hear is basically sampled and processed. And the question is, can we just start with computer models of physical systems, and from those models produce amazing audio which rivals what you can do with sampling and the real thing? And by doing it in that way, it enables you to manipulate it in interesting ways, to embed these sort of things in computer games, so Ryan Areas, game AI research, and the idea that you can put these fast computer models in systems and run them in dynamic and interesting ways, I just find hugely fascinating. And I think it's an area of definitely ripe for expansion in the future of exploration. I think that's probably enough for me, so please join me in welcoming Professor Reiss from what I'm sure is going to be a fascinating lecture from the World Leading Authority. And the title of the talk is, Do You Hear What I Hear? The Science of Everyday Sounds. So Josh, over to you.
They're not like they're not using stock photos like the sound designers do with the recorded samples. And what's more, animation can be created just by having the designers specify the actions in the scene, and that some rendering engine creates the animation from all of that. So I think there's an opportunity here for better and more creative sound design. Let's think of the sound effects not as just a sequence of bits played out, but instead focus on the sound generating mechanism, a procedure or a recipe that when implemented will produce the desired sound. And you can change that procedure slightly to create modified or new types of sound. This is the idea behind sound synthesis. It has a tremendous number of advantages over the other alternative approaches. So, sound synthesis could be used to create an arbitrary number of sounds, diverse sounds, like walking or running at arbitrary speeds on arbitrary surfaces with any type of choose. Sound samples are only a fixed number of pre-recorded and the synthesis methods can be controlled to create new sounds. Sounds that don't even exist in nature, even real, or the imagined sounds, like the sound of a dragon roaring, or Jedi knights fighting with lightsabers. So this represents a disruptive innovation. It's changing the marketplace, changing how we do things. And this idea of sound synthesis can create new approaches that matter. They matter not just to the professionals, but to the amateurs and to the consumers, to those consuming the new creative content. All of this addresses an industry need. But where's the science? So some basic research is needed here. Sounds are complicated, rich in information, with a lot of nuances that we don't fully understand. And how do you create the math, the equations, to render those sounds? Some sounds are fairly easy to create, like the sound of a phone. Where The goal is to simulate the entire system, the physics of everything associated with the creation of the sound. The sound itself is almost an incidental byproduct of the simulation. But those approaches sometimes take days to run just to produce a few seconds of sound. Not always, but they can. And they take many months of development. Furthermore, those methods don't always translate. The physical model that works for one engine won't be applicable for another type of engine because the physics are different. So that's where we are today in this field. There is fantastic work going on new methods to create sounds, but it's not addressing the needs of sound designers. That's not entirely true. The games community has been interested in procedural audio for quite some time. Procedural audio embodies this idea of sound as a procedure, not as a sample. It's about the recipe. Take simple sound sources, noises, pulses, tones, stir them together in the right amounts, bake them with filters, add some spice, and pretty soon you're starting to generate sounds like wind and rain and fire or engines. And the procedural community have started these methods, and it has seen a few implementations here and there. But getting any new technology into a game is very difficult. All of what's going on underneath inside the game console, it's different from one game to the next. And it doesn't, no simple solution works for all of them. Furthermore, these niche implementations, they can supplement, but they won't replace the sample libraries. So, a few years ago, the research team working with me, they developed a synthesis model that was a proof of concept of this idea of replacing the sample libraries. It was one model that replicates many different sounds in the BBC sound effects library, and can do that at fairly high quality, matching the characteristics of various sounds, such as an electric drill or a small boat motor.
Yet replicate the entirety of sounds.
thousands or even tens of thousands of sound effects. But we have a precious resource, the sound effects libraries themselves. Those are very high quality, bespoke recordings intended to be perfect exemplars of sound effects, tried, tested over decades. We can harness that information, we can mine that information. So we can look at and analyze all of those samples there to capture characteristics of different types of sounds. What is it that makes the sound of rain different from the sound of a running shower? What is going on in sounds that makes certain sounds startle us and certain sounds calm us? By looking at the features, we can uncover that sort of information. So, this is great. The same approach that hands creativity back to the sound designers, giving them new tools to manipulate and create sounds, and to provide new sonic experiences, also tells us so much about sound perception. Sorry.
You knew the joke before. This real war. But that was really interesting because you knew it was a joke. You knew it wasn't real. You could also hear various subtleties in the sound of pouring water. There was a lot going on there. There's this interesting interplay between your auditory sense, your hearing, and your visual sense. Sometimes my actions can support what I'm doing, but you might also have to resolve conflict between the two senses. And you can perceive a lot in something very simple, like pouring water. But can you perceive more? So I'm going to run a live experiment here. The back of the room is going to play two sound samples, and they're the only actual sound samples, recorded samples in the recording. One is going to be a hot water being poured, and one is going to be a cold water being poured. But I'm not going to tell you which is which. I'm going to ask you to guess which was hot being poured, which was cold being poured. So, Dave, you play the first sample. And the second sample. So, which sample do you think was which?
First was cold.
So, most people answered the first was cold. Most people of those who answered and didn't want to be put on the spot. And I've done this sort of thing in the classroom, and it's always the same. The vast majority of people can tell which is hot water and which is cold. If you listen over headphones, 99% sure you will get it right. Which is bizarre. You can hear heat. You can hear temperature. This is done on a subconscious level. It's not the type of thing we associate with sound. Why is it? I'm very curious about this question, but I'm not the only one who's very curious. The internet is great. You can find people discussing anything. Not always correct, but they will be discussing it. So, I looked online, and sure enough, people had been discussing this issue and answered it. One of the answers went like this. Well, cold water is more viscous or sticky. So almost like if you consider when water gets very cold, it turns into ice, and that's certainly extremely sticky. And so it makes loud splash sounds, sticky splash sounds. The splashes are higher frequency, higher pitch. Therefore, cold water is higher pitched than hot water. That makes a lot of sense. But there's another argument online that says hot water has bubbles in it. Those bubbles ring and they pop. And that makes high frequency sounds. Therefore, hot water is higher pitched. Wait a minute, they can't both be right. So I did a little analysis looking at some of the recordings. And it turns out they're both wrong. If you look at the recordings, you can find out that the same frequencies are dominating both recording. Therefore, they both have the same pitch. So, the effect is something different. There's subtleties going on in the sound. The strengths, the relative strengths of those frequencies are subtly different. So the texture, the tumble of information in the sound is different, even though they have the same pitch. But no one had bothered to look at this. No one had run a simple experiment or done critical analysis. It's an example of a faulty assumption, this idea that just because an explanation makes sense, it's the right one. It also demonstrates the importance of the scientific method. Nothing is known until it's tried and tested and confirmed repeatedly. But it is really interesting, this idea that we're here in temperature, that there's understanding of sound on a subconscious level. And it's a very subtle effect. And audio engineers have a rich tradition of manipulating these subtle aspects in audio, especially with music. Because in music, it's not just the musicians and the performers who are creating it, and the composers who are creating it. There's the sound engineer, specifically the mixing engineer. They deal with many different sources, many sound sources, all at the same time. A band, guitar, bass, drums, and multiple microphones on the drum kit, and vocals. They all need to be mixed together, all need to be heard. There are different sources, they can be masking each other, they can have different levels, there can be artifacts in the recording. And somehow, the sound engineer needs to combine them together and manipulate them, such that they all sound distinct, yet all contribute to a nice, clean blend of the sounds. This is not an easy task, and it requires a professional. Music production technologies, like what you see here, can help. And these are quite typical. They're massively complicated. In fact, over time, things have become more functional for the user. But they haven't become easier. Again, going back to video technology, there's a wide range of intelligent features in cameras, like what you would have on your phone. They guide the user. Things like face, scene, motion detection, auto effects, and red eye removal. But modern audio recording and editing devices, they have none of this. They're essentially deaf. They don't listen to the incoming audio. They don't have knowledge of the sound scene or of their intended use. Essentially, there's no autofocus for audio. That last one wasn't my idea. They suggested that. But can this be changed? With things like Alexa and Siri, things are moving in that direction. But still, it's not there, not anywhere close to as intuitive as this device is. In fact, we're so used to bad audio, we no longer even talk about it. We expect and we will notice that the images are on high quality. But we're perfectly comfortable watching and listening to YouTube videos and music on the phone if you expect that audio to be bad. So, can we change this? Can we put that level of intelligence into the audio devices? Can we essentially put a miniature sound engineer inside every mixing console, every digital audio workstation, every microphone? This would revolutionize music production. But doing this is not just challenging, it gets to the heart of some really basic questions related to sound engineering. What is art? What is science? What is the role of the music producer? Why do people prefer one mix of audio content over another? And unlike the sound effects, this is not a big data machine learning problem. So, ideally, what we would do is take lots of recordings that had been mixed and produced, and take the original content and simply extract information about the original sources, extract information about the produced content. And there's some sort of black box in between. You figure out that mapping. You don't have to fully understand it, but figure out that mapping from one to the other. And so, with new content, we just apply that same black box. light and somehow picks up for minutes. That's the idea behind a lot of machine learning. But in this case, we don't have the data. It's not that hard to get produced from it. Take every number one hit over the last few decades. Those number one hits are great examples of wonderful mixes. But the content that went into that mix is some of the most highly prized and highly guarded creative content that exists. That's what the record companies use to create soundtracks, advertisements, remixed and remastered versions, and they're not going to give away. Furthermore, mixing is a skilled craft, and a machine learning system will be fundamentally flawed if it doesn't take that information from the domain experts. You see, there's this myth that as long as we have enough data, we can solve almost any problem. But lots of problems can be solved that way. I thought weather forecasting worked that way. I thought what we did with weather forecasting was we take all the measurements of pressure, humidity, temperature, we take those measurements today, find when similar conditions had existed in the past, and just find out what happened the day after those similar conditions, that should tell us tomorrow as well. But I was speaking to a meteorologist, someone who does this sort of thing, and he told me that's not at all how it works. Even with all that information, that's a lousy prediction of tomorrow as well. Probably most of the people in this room are familiar with bad predictions. That would be even worse. So what they actually did is they built essentially a simulation how clouds interact, how pressure fronts work, what causes it to rain, all of that information, and they have these models of the world, at least of local weather systems, and they run that model from one day to the next to estimate tomorrow's weather. That gives a lot better estimates. They just tweak those models as new data comes in, continually tweaking and refining them. So this is one of those examples where machine learning approaches don't work. Furthermore, it's not traditional signal processing, this task of putting intelligence in there. Now, sound engineers do traditional signal processing. There's an element of that, noise production techniques, source separation. But most of those, on the intelligent tools for doing them, are not created with the sound engineer in mind. They're not created looking at what's happening in a mixed, real-world. And it's not multi-channel signal processing either. Multi-channel signal processing deals with situations like GPS. You're driving in your car, and you need to receive that signal, the GPS signal, to your sat-nav, buried in all of the noise of the environment around you. Multi-channel signal processing is focused on extracting information that has been mixed. In this case, we're trying to figure out how to mix towards some artistic vision, how to do that combination. There are other challenges involved. The music production and perception is not well understood. Why does one mix make you laugh and cry, and one mix sound up? Even though they are both mixing the same song, and both being performed by competent sound engineers. And there are lots of studies of how we perceive sounds when they interact. But most of those studies are dealing with things like a pure tone, this D with some background noise in the presence, and how the loudness has changed with the background noise. We need to deal with situations like a band playing, the guitar, bass, drums, and vocals, and what is the intelligibility of the vocals and the presence of all of those resources. So we know this is a challenging problem. Multiple techniques need to be applied. And the researchers working with me have been looking at those multiple techniques. One of the first approaches that we apply is knowledge engineering. As machine learning related techniques go, this is very unclear. This is our fashion. Knowledge engineering is something that people did 30 or more years ago, but it doesn't involve any fancy math. Basic idea is we're looking at a situation where there are experts. So let's ask them. You mix, but have you learned? But that's not easy to do. If you ask a famous record producer what they did on some hit record, you get an answer like, well, I turned it up to 11 to make it sound flat. How do you turn that into a mathematical equation? To give you an example, we have a system to prevent acoustic feedback. Feedback is that scenario where a singer steps up to a microphone for the first time and you hear most people who've gone to gigs have experienced that at some point. Annoying how. We thought that our approach was basically replicating how the sound engineers address that problem during a live show. So, talking to an experienced live sound engineer, I asked him, so when was the last time you had a feedback problem at home? And he said, never. I don't have any feedback problems. Not me, I know what I'm doing. And I thought that was a rather strange answer, because I knew it was a common problem. Are you sure? Never, ever? No, not me. Well, maybe it happened to someone else sometime in the past, and they said, well, yeah, okay, I am aware of potentially happening at some point. Great, tell me about it. And he said, okay, I was doing this gig yesterday. But it is a tricky situation. The sound engineers are experts. And they also have their own trade secrets, in a sense. He needs to protect his reputation as well. But it's more about the fact that a highly gifted practitioner is not sitting back and saying, what does the academic researcher need to know about what I'm doing? So, very challenging to use that approach, but there is a wealth of information that the sound engineers have. There's also listening technique. If we don't know how levels should be set, let's get a lot of people, get all of you in the room, have you listen to the content, and adjust the knob until it sounds right for you. That fills in a lot of the knowledge. And machine learning approaches can be applied as well. We've been building them, along with colleagues from Birmingham, right now, test beds, collections, multi-track audio. So lots of different songs that we have access to, and the mixes of those songs, and evaluation of those mixes from all around the world, where we now have enough data to mine that data for additional information. Putting all this together, we have been able to create intelligent systems to make it easier. So I'll give you an example right now. This nice interface like what one usually sees on mixing control. But the interface isn't necessary, just so you can see what it is doing. And when I start playing this video, it should sound really bad. That's because we don't have anything turned on. Step by step, we'll turn on a few of the technologies. And this is a very early prototype, but it certainly suffices to give you an idea of what. A student reporting competition. But we didn't tell them that the mix, the sound that we entered into that competition was done by essentially an artificial intelligence. We were in fact cheating. One of the rules of the competition was that everything had to be mixed by students. And instead, the system was mixed by a computer program written by a student. We didn't win, of course. It's nowhere near good enough to win. But what's interesting was the responses of the judges. I went up to all of them afterwards and asked for additional feedback and then told them what we had done. And the first couple of judges offered some interesting criticism, some good aspects, some bad aspects, things that should be done. And then when I told them what we had done, they were surprised and intrigued. The third judge, again, offered interesting criticism. And when I told him what had been done, he said, and a couple of people in the room do know him. Turns out he's a great guy, but I didn't know it at the time. But when I told him what had been done, he said, oh, I knew it all along. That was rubbish. You could tell him right from the beginning. It is controversial. Are we taking away creativity? Are we taking away jobs? Are we making music sound all the same? These sorts of questions come up time and time again with automation. It goes back to the Luddite movement in the 1800s. The Luddites were textile workers. They smashed up the machinery because they were concerned that the machines might be taking away their jobs. And more importantly for them, it turned out, they were concerned that they would have to be retrained and reskilled in their craft. But I think people should look at it from other perspectives. As the graffiti artist, Banksy, who's done a lot of work near here, has said, all artists are willing to suffer for their work, but why are so few prepared to learn to draw? In order to create great work, you first have to create pretty good work. You first have to learn the books and learn them well, and then you know how to break those books or to do something really interesting beyond that. That's what he was getting at. And mixing, as I mentioned before, is both technical and creative. Some of those technical challenges are mundane or frustrating. Sometimes assistive tools will really help the sound engineer. So I have another example here. It's a phenomenon called plume filter. Basically, if you have two microphones recording the same source, but they're different distances from that source, one of those microphones might capture a signal at its peak, or a frequency within that signal at its peak, while the other one captures it at its trough, its minimum value. So they'll cancel out. It makes the sound dull. So we have a simulation of a piano with eight microphones recording, and they're all different positions. So we're going to turn on a system that automatically time aligns the signal, turn it off, turn it on, back and forth. And like the previous example, you should get the message completely from just watching the video. All those situations where there isn't a sound engineer. So the band practicing in the garage. They're not going to hire a sound engineer to have decent sound in the practice sessions. Or the small pub venue that don't have the resources for a sound engineer. For the musicians in the audience, you're sure you're aware you've had these situations when the sound engineer is just as drunk as everyone else in the audience. Or for the income venue, where there's dozens, sometimes even hundreds of different sounds that are all being rendered simultaneously. And there is a miniature remnant sound engineer inside the game mixing it all together at the same time. So it's all about the consumers there. And the mixing engineers, they really want this high quality artistic mix. But the artistry of the mix is not the only thing they care about. They're interested, some would say obsessed with fidelity. They want the highest quality audio signal to come to the listener. They want the experience for the listener to be as close as possible to therapy, to if they are having the musicians performing live in front of them. That sense of immersion, of realism. And that's not an easy thing to do, because we're taking those sound bits, converting it to a digital format, converting it back out to sound from lab screens. So what level of fidelity do we need? How do we get as close as possible to the live experience? Luckily, there's a very well-established theory for this. And so I'm going to condense a few pages of dry academic lectures into about 1 minute. We only hear frequencies, those are tones, up to about 20 kilohertz, give or take. If you in the room wouldn't hear anything close to that. 20 kilohertz means 20,000 cycles of a signal per second. Very high number. There's a theorem that says that if in order to encode something up to 20 kilohertz, you need to sound like twice that big, at least twice that big, so 40 kilohertz. That theorem was discovered by Harry Nyquist and Paul Shannon. Paul Shannon is a very interesting character. Harry Nyquist wants him up. Paul, in addition to the sampling theorem, he also came up with a rocket-powered frisbee, gasoline-powered frisbee, a calculator that worked on Roman numerals, the fundamental equation of juggling that explains how long each ball spends in the air if an octopus were trying to juggle. Or the 1960s psychology experiments where you have a mouse running through a maze and you try to figure out what sense the mouse is using to find the cheese. Paul Shannon built robot mice to compete and race against the real mice. He also came up with information theory, which is one of the most fundamental things for broadband today. You can tell I'm a big fan. One more thing about Paul Shannon. So he was a close personal friend of Alan Turing. And Turing referred to what is now known as the Turing machine as the brain. And in Turing's notes one time, he said, Paul is crazy. He wants to do all sorts of cultural things with the brain. He wants to play music to it. So Paul Shannon was one of the first people think of computer music. But getting back to his theorem, so it essentially says we need to sample signals at 40 kilohertz in order to be able to fully represent that signal. Compact disc, the sampling rate that it uses, is 44.1 kilohertz, a bit beyond that. So that should, it seems, be good enough. But a lot of audio engineers and audiophiles don't use. In their work, they use 96 kilohertz, way beyond that. Are they crazy? They swear they hear a difference. The sampling theorem seems to say you shouldn't hear a difference. Some people think that the audio engineers who are working with high-resolution audio are all fooling themselves. They've been sold snake oil. Lots of people are skeptical about this work. Yet, those audio engineers, some of them are the most highly respected names in the industry. And there's a whole industry providing recording and playback equipment for working with this high quality. This is a subject that audio engineers debate about a lot. And around the same time, I was hearing all this debate. I went to a dinner party one night. I was sat across from a PhD student, and I asked the PhD student, always interested in this sort of thing, what he was researching. He told me it was meta-analysis. Meta-analysis is basically when you take the results of lots of different studies and you pull all of that information together, hopefully to find something deeper and more meaningful about the questions that those studies are leading. So, bingo, I'll do a meta-analysis on this question of perception of high-resolution memory. So, scoured the literature, talked to people all over, looked at papers, at reference papers, at reference papers, to find every single study that had ever looked into this question. In the end, I found 18 studies with data directly relevant to the question that could be used in our analysis. In one of the studies, it was literally found by the researcher by looking in the back of a dusty old filing cabinet at the back of his office where he had some Xerox copies of the old paper. Of those 18 studies, every one of them I was able to get the full data from. In one case, I had to redirect it, except one. That one was a bit strange because they had lost their data. And when I asked them for details about the experiment, they got quite angry. But the meta-analysis itself was really interesting. Lots of researchers had thought they had seen an effect that in their study they had shown perception when they hadn't. Similarly, in other studies, people had thought they hadn't shown an effect, but they had. So, and there were lots of flaws in the studies. In one study, the high resolution content wasn't really high resolution. They had taken CDs and just played them back in a different format. So, there was no difference in the study for anybody to find. And what about that one study where they had lost their data? Luckily, they did report some of their data in the study itself. And it basically went like this. There were 55 participants. They each did 10 trials. And in each of those trials, they listened to high-resolution content, listened to standard content, and in some way have to guess which is which. So when you look at all of their data from the 55 participants, it's almost exactly 50% correct. In other words, no better than chance, as if they flipped a coin every time to guess which is which. But they did mention a few things about their study. Men performed a lot better than women. Audiophiles, people massively obsessed with this, performed a lot better than casual listeners. Older people performed a lot better than younger listeners. Yet despite all of that, only 3 people out of the 55 ever got 6 out of 10 correct. So some simple statistical analysis will show you that the chances of that is like winning the lottery twice. And the chance of that sort of thing happening, even if there was an effect to be perceived, is still like winning the lottery. So the only conclusion you can make from this is either the authors of the study were really not right, and let's be polite and say that probably not the case, or they have faked their data. Neither one looks good, but it's rather shocking because that was the study that is most well known and the study that most said that there was no difference to be detected. In fact, when you pull all the studies together, it showed a rather strong ability to detect the difference between high-resolution audio and standard formats. The biggest effect of the meta-analysis was created. If you take people off the street, even if they're experienced in working with audio, and if you tell them this is how the interface works, go do the test, then they only performed a very small bit better than chance. It was statistically significant, but still, yeah, 52% rather than 50, hundreds or even thousands of trials, but not that big. But if you train them for the test, if you tell them what to listen for, if you get focus groups together, and have them talk about what they're hearing. Maybe have them do a practice test where they are told when they've gotten it right and gotten it wrong. Then, the next day, take those people back and under double-blind controlled conditions, they performed way better than chance. In fact, once they had been trained, in the studies with trained listeners, the worst or the least significant result with trained listeners was still greater than the most significant result with untrained listeners. So it appears we can hear a difference here. We just don't know what to listen for. We haven't been trained to focus on this difference. So I published this study in the Journal of the Audio Engineering Society, and it got a lot of, it made a big splash. There were a few interviews and lots of discussions on the internet and social media and various other places in the press, people talk about it. And that's when I found out people on the internet are crazy. Most of you already know this, but I was called a shill, a charlatan, paid by the recording industry, all sorts of names that I can't pronounce in this room. And it was attacked by both sides. There were a community who believed that the ability to hear this difference should be much stronger than was shown in the study, and there was a community who believed that there isn't a difference to be heard at all. My favorite quote from all of the discussion online was, "Call me an intellectually dishonest placebo file apologist." Whoever wrote that just puts time and effort into coming up with such a description. And it wasn't just on the internet that people were crazy. So at an audio engineering society, two people were discussing the paper. One of them is, and I know a couple of people in the room know this guy. One of them is an audio inventor, multi-Grammy award-winning mixing engineer. And the other one discussing the paper was a chief scientist at a very well-respected audio technology company for many years. Well, it started off with just a normal discussion about the paper, then got into a heated discussion, then a shouting match, and then finally pushing and shoving before it was broken up by a mastering engineer who had worked on several Oscar-winning films. So that is a highlight of my career. Research at a conference. But what is going on here? Why do we hear a difference? Because on the surface, it seems like the sampling curve says we should. And here's what I think is happening. There's another important theorem besides the Sandheim theorem, the uncertainty principle. So it was discovered in the 1920s, Werner Heisenberg. It says that position and momentum of a particle can't be fully resolved at the same time. But around the same time that Shannon came up with the Sandheim theorem, or at least put it down on paper, how he had the original idea, around the same time, a Hungarian-born British physicist, Denis Gabor, showed that the uncertainty principle, at its heart, is not about physics. It's fundamental math, and it applies in lots of cases. And where it's most relevant for audio is that you can't resolve time and frequency completely. If you focus something completely in time, you spread it out in frequency and vice versa. So when we are sampling audio, we need to remove very high frequency content, even if it's not heard. If we want to keep just everything below 20 kHz or 40 kHz sample rate, we need to remove those high frequencies, otherwise it creates other distortions. But when we do that, we're spreading the signal in time, just a little bit. A sound like this becomes spread by a millisecond or two. It's a small effect. But a millisecond or two spreading of a sound, it's known, can be perceived. And so there is a difference to be heard. So we've seen a few things here. Sound shape our world. In TV, film, virtual reality, we recreate those sounds or create unreal sounds to capture the imagination. But what are the limits of the auditory system? Can we use our auditory system and feed back this very dense information to do better, higher quality sound production? And to understand this, we need to look in detail at the human auditory system. So sounds come in to our ears, and in our inner ear is one of the most amazing, looking at the doctors in the audience, one of the most amazing organs in the human body, the cochlea. The cochlea is lined with 3,500 inner hair cells. and they are connected to 30,000 neurons. These inner hair cells, they resonate in response to the different frequencies, the different tones that come in as you're hearing. The 30,000 neurons they are connected to fire some 600 pulses per second up to that. So what our ears basically have is very high quality time and frequency analyzers with digital outputs. Audio engineers would pay good money for that sort of thing. And we have two of them, three, inside our heads. But that information gets sent to the auditory cortex, where all of that information is combined together to produce what's known as an oral activity image, the sensations of hearing that we are getting. That image is compared with images from other senses, with previous images, with context, to build up an oral scene. And all of this information in the auditory cortex is connected to some 100 billion brain cells. And there are 500 trillion connections. No one knows the exact number, but we know it's pretty big. I look, some people say it's 100 trillion, some people say it's more than 500 trillion. Rest assured, it is a big number. But what is known is we can rewire these connections based on stimuli, based on experience. We can learn new ways to interpret the sounds that we are perceiving. It's up to us what we choose to do with the sounds. As we've shown, with hot and cold water, with sound design, with music production, with high-resolution audio, we can train ourselves to perceive and to create and perceive and appreciate a better auditory world. Thank you.
The next part of the evening, we're going to just go out to the foyer for the reception, where we have drinks and possibly some nibbles too. We don't have time for questions here, but Josh is going to be on hand the entire reception. We'll be happy to answer questions. And also possibly bring up fights if they occur as well. So that's the end of the time this lecture here, so we'll go next door and have this. Let's just thank Josh again. I've got to say, for any would-be professors in the room, you've just seen a fantastic example of how to give an inaugural lecture. So let's thank Josh again.